Hachette Audio presents Misty and Me, Life with the Invincible Bette Davis. Written by Kathryn Sermak with Danelle Morton. Read by Kathryn Sermak. For Misty, this is our book, our story, our blood, sweat, tears, and laughter. Times change, but the wisdom you shared with me is everlasting. I am forever grateful for your love and the tutelage you gave me. This book is also for your fans, to whom you bequeath lessons on a well-lived life. Love, Kath. Darling Gigi, may this dictionary stand you in good stead while writing the legend. Mamo. Preface, July 22, 1985, Paris. Don't be afraid to face your fears. They won't go away until you do. I looked out the window of my apartment on the Rue Robert Fleury to confirm that the car and driver were waiting for me in the street below. Miss Davis's plane was scheduled to land at the Charles de Gaulle Airport in 3 hours, and it had been my practice, as her personal assistant, to arrive 2 hours before the plane landed to ensure that all arrangements were in place. I saw the chauffeur, Patrick, well-dressed in his pressed black suit and tie, standing next to the gleaming black Mercedes. The driver was new to me, recommended by the U.S. Embassy, which assured me that he was trustworthy, discreet, and skilled at evading the paparazzi. The date of Misty's arrival had been the top item in Celebrity News, a weekly bulletin that announced prominent people visiting Paris and their agendas. Patrick had to get us past customs and out of Charles de Gaulle to the Orly Airport on the other side of Paris and onto our flight to Biarritz. Given the state of Misty's health, I wanted to make sure that no one got any photos of us as we made our way to Orly. As the car glided down the periphérique, I took out my datebook to triple-check the preparations for our stay in Biarritz and the return to Paris. I'd met 2 weeks earlier with the manager at the Hotel du Palais in Biarritz, a resort town on the Atlantic near the French border with Spain, and had spoken with him again yesterday to reconfirm the details. Miss D and I would stay 10 days at the Hotel du Palais, where we would work on her second memoir, This and That. I had reserved her an ocean view suite with a large terrace facing the Bay of Biscay, while I would be across the hall in a junior suite. Her rooms would be decorated with gardenias, if available. If not, daisies were Miss D's second choice. A bottle of Puy Fusé would be chilling in an ice bucket, with a bottle of club soda when we arrived. Since her stroke 2 years ago, Misty could only drink wine spritzers. I had met also with the head chambermaid to ensure that the same maids attended to the suite morning and evening, arriving precisely at 9 a.m. to clean and returning at 8 p.m. to turn down the beds and place a sheet over the top blanket, making a proper coverture. The head chambermaid assured me that there would be enough hangers in the closets to hold the clothes I would unpack from Misty's multiple suitcases. Satisfied that everything was arranged, I closed my datebook and settled back into my seat as Paris rushed past the window. I pictured Misty, easy to do, as we had seen each other in New York a few months before. In my 6 years as her full-time live-in assistant, a position I had just recently left, though I was still part of her intimate inner circle, I'd rarely seen her so rattled. The storm had been brewing for several weeks. I'd flown back to New York for her birthday in April and to attend a meeting with Miss D's lawyer, Harold Schiff. Harold had discovered that Beatty, her nickname for her daughter, Barbara Hyman, had written a tell-all memoir in the style of Mommy Dearest, scheduled to be published that Mother's Day. Miss D's agent, Robbie Lance, had joined us in her suite at the Lombardi Hotel to discuss how to handle Bette's upcoming public betrayal of her mother. The timing could not have been worse. Misty had just started working again after a 1983 stroke that nearly killed her. We did not tell her about the book before she flew to London to work on the film Murder with Mirrors, fearing that if she knew, she might suffer a setback or worse. We told her only after the movie had wrapped. She was deeply wounded, but she seemed to have bounced back. That afternoon in the Lombardy, she was very much in charge. With Harold and Robbie seated on the beige sofa in the large living room of the suite, Misty was smoking and pacing. I stood at the edge of the room, ready to act if anyone needed anything. Misty wore a crisp navy blue dress with a flared skirt, nipped in at the waist and with a stiff, angled collar that accentuated her neckline. She had three of these stylish tailored dresses in different colors, all made of sturdy poplin that did not wrinkle when she sat. She rarely sat. Misty thought more clearly when she paced. That afternoon, she was quietly seething, her eyes ablaze with energy. She took firm, quick steps and turned decisively on her heel, with the same pace she had that summer in 1979 when she hired me. Since her stroke, those steps had become more tentative and her turn was not as quick. At the Lombardi that day, her vigor had returned and she stepped and turned crisply back and forth across the room. "I cannot believe she's doing this to me," Misty said. "How could she?" She paused at the credenza and consulted a list of questions on a yellow legal pad, taking the pad with her as she finally sat in a chair opposite the sofa. "How do we know for sure it's a wretched book?" Misty asked Harold. "My source has tried to get me a copy, but the publisher has it securely locked up. Those allowed to read it are only permitted to do so in their offices. Rumor has it that she paints a very unflattering portrait of you," Harold said. "Well, find a way to read it and then tell me," Misty said. "Bette, I'm told the same thing," Robbie said in his gentle voice with a slight German accent. "Word has it that it is a scathing book and a ferocious attack on you. We must discuss what your response to the press will be." "This is just horrible. Bette has no idea what the press will do to her," Misty said. "She told me she wrote this book so we would have a better understanding of one another. I'm now utterly confused by who she is and her way of life." "I'm sure Mrs. Hyman will be doing interviews, but from what I've heard, many of the networks are standing by you," Robbie said. "I've had many requests. Mike Wallace at 60 Minutes said he will re-air your interview where Bette spoke glowingly about you." "Kath, make a note," Misty said, looking at me. "I wish to call and thank him." I could see her mounting distress as she stood, lit a cigarette, and walked across the room to the window. She put out that half-finished cigarette and lit another. She made a long exhale as she looked out at Manhattan, and then took another thoughtful drag. We all sat in silence as she sorted her thoughts. Then Miss D turned toward us. "She's expecting me to lash out and have a fight," she said. "Oh, yes, she is. Well, I will not dignify her by giving her response to her so-called book. No, I will not. I will say nothing and give no interviews in reply." There was a certain tone when Miss D had decided, a voice of dark refusal that contained all the sorrow of this betrayal, as well as her firm resolve. Anyone who knew her well understood that when she spoke in this way, there would be no further discussion. Since then, Bette's book had become the biggest entertainment media event in the weeks leading up to Mother's Day. In it, she described a traumatic childhood and a drunk, neglectful mother. For all the strength Miss D had displayed at the Lombardy, her voice was barely audible when she and I spoke by phone after I returned to Paris. Miss D was a fighter, a champion, and a bon vivant, and always a survivor. But after she read Bette's book, Miss D described waking up to feelings of dread and told me she never wanted to see anybody again. Yet somehow she had made it onto this plane for our long-planned French adventure, working on the book by the beach, and then a 4-day road trip from Biarritz to Paris, where she could see my new place. I was shifting in my shoes as the Concorde came into view, eager to see her after such a long time. No matter what state she was in when she boarded the plane, I knew her mood would be improved by a visit to the ocean. I was so happy to help her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.